In this video, I'd like to talk about which camera you should convert to infrared. This could include full spectrum conversions or conversions to various IR cutoffs, which I'll generically refer to as infrared or IR. Selecting a camera to convert to IR can be complicated. First of all, there's all the normal decision processes that are involved in selecting a camera. Then there's the process of converting the camera. Then you have to consider all of the limitations imposed by infrared photography. All of these factors can lead to a certain amount of analysis paralysis, especially if this is the first time you've converted an infrared camera. I've owned three infrared cameras, two cameras which I've purchased and then had converted to infrared, and then a third camera which I purchased already converted to full spectrum. I'd like to share some of my thoughts around the decision-making process in buying or converting infrared cameras. The first issue to consider is focusing. For DSLRs that focus through the viewfinder, this focus is calibrated for visible light. However, it's not accurate in infrared. The focus needs to be recalibrated, but to only work with a specific lens, and this is really limiting. Mirrorless cameras or the live view mode on DSLRs using the rear screen or a digital viewfinder don't have this limitation. Therefore, I recommend converting a mirrorless camera or a DSLR with a good live view screen or digital viewfinder for the best results. The next consideration is, should you buy new or used? If you purchase a new camera, be sure to use it before having it converted. If the camera's defective or you need to have it replaced, you want to know that before spending the money on a conversion. If you buy a used camera, you are going to want to test the camera, but you may want to consider buying it from a reputable source that will test and inspect the camera and maybe even offer a limited warranty as well. Be sure to test the camera yourself before sending it off for conversion. Another great option is to purchase an already converted camera from one of the companies that does infrared conversions. This is a great option because it's sort of a one-stop shop. They've tested and inspected the camera, they've converted it however you like, and then you can just purchase from them directly. Another great option is to convert a camera that you already own to infrared. This could be a second camera, or it could be that you're upgrading your primary camera and you're going to take your old camera and convert that to infrared. You're already familiar with it, and that can make a great option for converting a camera to infrared. The next consideration is ecosystem. Do you already own a camera and all of the lenses, batteries, accessories that go with that camera? Well, then it might make sense to convert a camera to infrared that's in that same ecosystem. That way you don't have a different set of lenses, a different set of batteries, a different set of chargers to carry around with you to support that camera. You can share all of those things between a single system. I have cameras that are conventional cameras and infrared cameras that all use the same ecosystem, the same brand, the same lens mount, the same lenses, the same batteries, the same chargers, and that really makes it convenient. The other thing to keep in mind is you're going to want to use a camera that you're comfortable with. By using a brand or a mount that you use already, then you're already going to be comfortable with that line of cameras, and then that will make the challenges of dealing with infrared less complicated because you're not trying to learn a new camera system on top of it. The next consideration is lenses. In infrared photography, many lenses create a hot spot in the center of the image. This is a blown out portion of the image because the lens is designed to focus light in the visible portion of the spectrum, but not in infrared. And therefore that lens either doesn't work with infrared or it doesn't work at a certain aperture. So it's important to understand, with the camera that you want to use and the lenses that you want to use, will they support infrared photography? There's lots of research you can find on the internet, depending on the lenses you're using, the brand of lens, the model, the mount, help you determine if those lenses have hotspots or not. It's a lot of testing that you can look up and save you a lot of time and save you the expense of purchasing a lens that won't work for infrared photography. So be sure to check this out. There also can be a difference between primes and zooms. Now, this can vary depending on the manufacturer. My experience has been that, in general, zooms tend to have more hotspots than primes, but that's not necessarily the case with all manufacturers. So be sure to keep that in mind. The last thing you want to do is spend money on a lens only to find out that it won't work for infrared photography. One of the benefits of shooting digital infrared photography is the wide variety of looks that you can get out of a single camera. For example, with a camera converted to full spectrum, you can use external filters to give you a chrome look or to give you a whole variety of infrared cutoffs or to even have a UV look if you want to shoot that. Another example is with a camera converted to 590 nanometers, filter internally, you could still use external filters of 720 or 850 or higher, anything higher than the internal conversion. So you've got lots of flexibility, but in order to take advantage of this flexibility, you'll need to use external lens filters. If you have a single lens that you shoot infrared with, you can just simply buy external filters of the one thread size to match your single lens. However, if you have multiple lenses that you'd like to use and they have different filter thread sizes, then you will need to accommodate that either through step-up rings or through even buying multiple filters to accommodate those if the sizes vary widely enough. So certainly something to consider. Some cameras, especially in the point-and-shoot range, don't support external filters at all. Some may allow you to use an adapter to then be able to add filters, but some simply won't have that support. So that's something to be aware of when considering various cameras. Another factor you'll wish to consider is sensor size and image quality. The smallest sensors are typically found in point-and-shoot cameras. They'll offer the lowest level of quality, but the highest degree of portability. Next up is Micro Four Thirds, which is very popular for infrared, mainly due to the small camera size and lower weight. Then we have APS-C, which is also kind of in a sweet spot, combining good image quality but small form factor. Next up is full frame, which we start to get into bigger cameras, bigger lenses, more weight, of course, higher quality, but then you have to pay for that in terms of dollar cost and weight. And then finally, at the highest end, there's medium format, which produces spectacular quality images, but at the extreme cost of cost and weight for that. So you really have to decide. That's more of a balance for what your personal taste is and what you'd like to see out of your digital infrared photography. The next factor you'll wish to consider is weight. For many infrared photographers, they travel or they shoot landscapes, they hike, and so you're carrying your gear a long way. And so the weight of your gear is going to be a factor. This is something that could push you towards a smaller sensor size, such as an APS-C or a Micro Four Thirds sensor. Another factor to consider in weight is not just the weight of the body, but the weight of the lenses. There are some cameras, even full frame cameras, that are extremely small and lightweight, but the lenses that work best with those cameras can be much heavier. So when you're considering weight, be sure to factor in not just the body, but all of the lenses that you'll be using. As a result of those types of combinations, many infrared photographers will lean towards APS-C or Micro Four Thirds as a sweet spot of having both really good image quality and really low weight. Here are some of the things that you may not need in an infrared camera. First of all, high ISO or low light performance. You're going to be doing most of your shooting in broad daylight, and therefore a low ISO will be fine. You may not need the latest and greatest camera because of its low light performance. Next is weather resistance and weather sealing. These may be great in adverse weather conditions, but again, if we're shooting on a sunny day, then you may have less of a need for those in your infrared camera. Next is a high frame rate for continuous shooting. Most of the subjects you're shooting probably will be not moving so fast, giving you plenty of time to take your shot. So high continuous frame rates may not be that important. Built-in flash? Don't think so. Don't need it. And video. Some people might be shooting some video in infrared, but for most people you're going to be using infrared for still photography. And the final consideration is the one that only you can decide, and that's cost. There's quite a range of cost for infrared photography. You can look at point-and-shoot cameras that might cost only a few hundred dollars, all the way up to medium format cameras that cost thousands or even tens of thousands of dollars. And what your tolerance is, what you want to spend, is really up to you. But there is quite a variety available. I find, for me and for many other people, that there is this sweet spot that exists in APS-C cameras and Micro Four Thirds cameras, both in terms of a sweet spot for the cost, the weight, the image quality. All of those things lead us towards those sort of middle-of-the-road systems, the APS-C and Micro Four Thirds. But ultimately, the cost, what you're willing to spend on both the camera and the conversion and the accessories, the lenses, the filters, that's really up to you. Okay, now that we've covered the considerations for an infrared camera, let's get into some more specific recommendations. First, let's talk about point and shoots. There are many point and shoot cameras from a variety of manufacturers which can be converted to infrared. Check with the conversion companies to see if the point and shoot you're interested in can be converted. Many of these conversions are less expensive than converting a mirrorless or DSLR camera. If a conversion is offered, then it's more than likely that the included lens won't have hotspots. Another bonus. For the rest of these cameras, consider that the budget options are cameras under $1,000 and the higher end options are over $1,000. Let's start with Canon. Canon has a large number of budget APS-C DSLRs. You can get new or used cameras in the SL or the T series. One of my first infrared conversions was an SL1. You slap an EFS 24 millimeter pancake lens on that and you've got a great little package for shooting infrared. A used SL1 can be had for under $200. The SL2 and the SL3 both have a flip out screen, making them even more flexible for infrared shooting. Also, the T series is great as well if you would like a little bit more functionality, but the sensors can be pretty much equivalent to the SL series. So those are some great budget options. Lots of lenses available, both new and used, very affordable. Also, on the budget side for Canon is their APS-C mirrorless lenses. That's the M series. Those could be good options as well. If you want to go more high-end with Canon, then I would recommend in their full-frame mirrorless lineup, the R or the RP series. These are going to be bigger cameras with much bigger lenses, but with higher image quality. Next up is Fuji. Fuji is what I currently shoot. There's lots of great options there on the budget APS-C front. You've got used cameras such as the X-T1, X-T2, X-T20, X-H1, or you can get a newer camera such as the X-T200, the X-T30, or the X-A7. These are all great. The thing that I like about Fuji is the small size, the lightweight, and the high quality lenses. The lenses are small and lightweight as well, so lots of great options there. If you want to go to a higher end APS-C camera from Fuji, then you can look at the X-T3 or X-T4. And if you want to get really crazy with Fuji, you can go to the medium format and get the GFX50R, which is much bigger, much heavier, much more expensive, and even more expensive to convert, but the image quality is going to be spectacular. On the Sony front, you've got a couple options. At the budget APS-C size, you can look at the A6000 series, the 6000, 6100, etc., all the way up to whatever they're at now, 6500. These are great cameras, very small, great image quality, and a really good selection of lenses available for these. At the higher end and the full frame for Sony, you've got the A7, the A7R series, much higher quality. Bodies aren't that much bigger, but the good lenses are going to be much heavier, so keep that in mind. For Nikon, on the budget side, you've got the APS-C DSLRs, the D four-digit series, so like the D3500, the D5600. These are, much like Canon, these are great options to convert to infrared because of the live view and the rear screen that you have. In the higher end for Nikon, I would look at their full-frame mirrorless options, such as the Z series. For Micro Four Thirds, there's lots of great cameras available from Olympus and Panasonic, all mirrorless, which can make great infrared cameras. Do you have any other considerations that you'd like to factor in before converting a camera to infrared? Or do you have any questions about a specific camera that you would like to convert to infrared? If so, be sure to leave a comment down below. Hope you enjoyed. Thanks.